Operating system structure. So in this video lecture we are going to know about the operating system structures. So what is the importance of the operating system structure is that OS must be well structured and engineered to proper and efficient functioning of the operating system. So we need to structure the different components of the operating systems so that we can get the efficient functioning of it. And operating system is, as we know, it is composed of different subsystems, and those subsystems may define some functioning, that is the task and input and the output. And operating system structure is basically an arrangement, the basic and organization or arrangement of different subsystems. As we have seen, first two, three, these are the subsystems to increase the performance of the computer and its implementation. We need a proper structure, and that structures is responsible for giving the efficient result from the operating system. So if we talk about the types of the structure of the operating system, so we have these five basic structures. So the first one is the simple structure, next one is layered architecture, third one microkernel approach we use to structure it, and the next one is the modular approach of the operating system structure, and fifth one is the hybrid system. So this evolution has development path from simple structure to came to the hybrid structure. So if we discuss about this simple structure, so in this simple structure we can see this. This generally we found in the case of the MS-DOS, that is Microsoft Disk Operating System. So this is the simplest structure we can see. This is the structure. Here we have the application programs and the resident system program. We have the MS-DOS device drivers and the ROM, random access, read-only memory, basic input output system device driver. So here we can see in this diagram, it's very clear that we have here ROM bus. So you can see here the application programs, whatever is there, it can interact directly to the resident system programs, and resident system program can interact with the MS-DOS device drivers available in that, and this is the hardware layer we can say. Here the ROM BIOS device drivers, and this is responsible for starting the system, starting the operating system. So we can look here, we have the different components here and how they are well connected to each other. So we can also see the connection. If we see the connections also, application program directly have the access to the hardware layer, that is the ROM BIOS device drivers, and apart from this, resident system programs is also having the direct access here to the ROM BIOS device drivers. So we can see, and from application to resident program, resident program to MS-DOS device driver, and this ROM BIOS device driver. So we have these connections, and it is thought to be very simplest architecture of the operating system. In this we can say here, so it is written to provide the most of the functionality in the least space. So this was the objective while building this one. So here, whatever application programs or applications we have, they have direct access and direct control over the operating system's hardware. So here, it has some advantage also, and this also treated as the disadvantage also. How the disadvantage is that? So in this approach, it's not modular, inefficient is there, low protection or security. So security and protection is the least bothered here, and that is also one drawback of this one, because the application programs, they have the direct access to the hardware layer and other layers also. So in this way, what will happen? This can make some changes which may crash the system. So in this way, security is a disadvantage here. And we can see here, it is the one thing is that it is the oldest structure, and there is no difference here between the user mode and the kernel mode. So one example we can see here, the MS-DOS and Linux was built over this one. Even this is the simplest also, and we can see it is the oldest structure, so but it has given the power to the other structure. Whatever disadvantage is there, it was removed in the next approach. So second one is we have the layered approach. So in that layered approach, we can see here we have the different layers. So in that, we can start from the layer 0, that is the hardware, then the intermediate layers, layer 1, layer 2, layer 3, and it goes to the layer n. And layer n is the user interface layer, from where the user interacts. So what had happened here, whatever the functionality was there, it is divided into the different layers. The responsibility was divided like this. So whatever the problem was there in the previous one, that is the direct access to the hardware and different layers directly access, here that problem is not there, because whatever request has to be made by the user interface, it has to go through these layers. So indirectly here we can see here the security is here, protection security is there. So what had happened, the zero layer is called the bottom layer and highest top layer is called the interface layer. And what had happened here, each layer, whatever, either this one or this one, whatever layer is there, these layers are developed and debugged independently here. So this is structure, this is if we it's look like that, if we cut onion and we see the front face, so whatever the structure will be seeing, that will be a layered like onion structure. So in this way they are there. So so there was one operating system that we call the THE operating system. So this layer design was first used in that. So it has mainly 6 layers, and these are as follows. We can see here, if we talk about the from the layer 0, so it's the hardware layer, and we have the CPU scheduling functions, and we have the memory management, process management, buffering for input and output devices, and the user programs. So they are arranged like that. But what is the advantages in this layered architecture? That is the simplicity of the construction and the debugging. So what is that? We can see here in this, what each layer can be independently developed and debugged. So this is also one advantage of it. So each layer is implemented with only those operations provided by the lower layer. So in this way we can see here, so if this layer is built, so this uses the functionality of this one. So like this, these layers are built. So meaning of this statement is, each layer is implemented with only those operations provided by the lower layers. So next, what is the advantage of it? Hard to decide how to split functionality into there. So it's the case of the chicken and egg situations arises. So here it's the situation arises, which functionality we have to keep first, or what must be the order, that is also a doubtful or confusing case. So but anyway, here some advantages are there. But if we want to divide the functionality into the different layers, then situations comes, how to arrange them in a proper order. So, but here it is a less efficient duty due to the high overhead. Higher layer to lower layer takes time to process, because the whatever request is made by the upper layer, it goes to the layers, to the hardware layer. So it creates a overhead, extra overhead to the operating system. So next approach is the microkernel approach. So this is also an advancement over the layered approach. So here what had happened, so here they have removed all the non-essential services from the kernel and implement them as the system applications. So whatever important services is there, that is compulsory, they are kept into the kernel, and whatever was not required, essential, they can be loaded at the requirement is there. So in this way, this approach has been used here. So in the microkernel, provide process and memory management and the message passing between the other services. This is the way of communication. So security and protection here improved, and most services perform in the user mode, not in the kernel mode. So lot of interference or disturbance is here for the kernel. So whatever problem is coming, if some wrong instruction or something wrong had happened, it will be done in only the user mode. Kernel mode will be unaffected out of this. So in the Mac and the Windows NT, this approach, microkernel based approach, is used here. So if we see this structure of the microkernel, we have, like, this is the IPC, we have the inter process communication, these are the basic components, IPC, memory management, and CPU scheduling. So these major tasks are kept into the kernel mode, and it was away from the user mode. So but in the kernel mode, these services are running, and application programs, file system, device driver, or process server, virtual machines is there here. Whatever services was there in the user mode, they can communicate to this kernel mode for different services using the message passing method. So if the application program has to communicate with this, first it will inform to this microkernel, and out of this the communication will be established with these application programs. So like this communication is happening, say for example from file system to device driver. So using the message passing it is happening. So in the message passing we use the send and receive, send and receive operations. So using that we perform this action. And here kernel, what the job of the kernel is, it interacts with the hardware to get the work done. And in the hardware, we already know, we have the memory, CPU, input output devices, etc. So in the microkernel, what had happened, we can see here the moves as much from the kernel into the user space. So the responsibility, lot of responsibility was taken back from the, it has been taken from the kernel to the user mode. So the size has reduced of the operating system. So here communication happens between the modules using the message passing. And what are the benefits? It's easier to extend the microkernel, and we have easier to port the operating system to new architectures, because in the kernel mode we have the less functionality we have kept there. So anytime if you want to add or you want to change, with less effort it can be done. It is more secure also, because the processes are running in the, most of the processes are running in the user mode for the user purpose. and for the system it is in the kernel mode. So it's some of the drawbacks is there: performance overhead of user space to kernel space communication is still here. So this is the drawback in this approach also. So next approach is that is used to remove this, to avoid this performance overhead by the message passing. So what here happened, the modular approach was used. So each of the services or whatever functionality we require, they were kept into the different modules. So suppose we require the services like device and bus drivers, scheduling classes, file system, loadable system calls, we have the executable formats, stream modules, miscellaneous other modules, whatever is there. So what had here done, these modules are now connected to the core kernel, and this approach was used in the Solaris Unix based operating system. And here what happens, these kernels are responsible to connect these modules directly. So from the diagram it is clear the direct connection is there here. So here modern, whatever the modern operating system is there, the development is here object oriented with a relatively small core kernel and the set of modules which can be linked dynamically. So what had happened here, in the object oriented approach it is a modular approach. Here the different modules are there. So these modules, what they can do, in that core we have the kernel, so they are, these modules are connected and not connected. What we can do, as per requirement these modules can be connected and they can be detached. So this dynamic linking can be used for the making the work to be done by the operating system. So in this, what happens, the example is the Solaris I already told. So modules are same as the layers. So in this previous approach we have seen here, the approach is like here in the layer wise hardware, CPU scheduling, memory management, process. So these are the different layers. So here also the same approach has been applied, and in that layered architecture it was layer, but here we call it is a module. So in these modules, these functionality was kept here. As per the requirements, they dynamically linked to the kernels and they can do the work for the operating system. So here whatever the problem was there, like in the layered architecture, that was the chicken and egg problem. In that, what was that, which came first, either chicken or egg? So what is happening, there is no such situations here. As per the requirement, they dynamically can be linked to the kernel and they can work, the work can be done. So that problem is here removed. So after this, what had happened, next approach is the hybrid approach. In the hybrid approach, what had happened, it is not a pure architecture, but is the combination of the architecture, any of the architecture. So that we call the hybrid. So what we are doing, we are combining multiple approaches to address the performance, security and usability needs. So taking into the consideration performance, security and usability, we build the hybrid approach. Suppose we can take some concept from the modular approach, and we can take the microkernel approach, and we can build a highly efficient system for this operating system structure. So in this way, Linux and the Solaris kernel in the kernel address space, so monolithic plus modular for dynamic loading of functionality. So we can see here Maybe you are using the hybrid approach here. And if we talk about the Windows, mostly monolithic, plus they also use the microkernel for the different subsystem and personalities. So what is here? We have covered here the operating system structure. So we have seen the, if we see, the first one was the simple structure that was used in the MS-DOS. Next we have seen the layered approach. So we have used the layered approach, and after layered approach, the third one was the, we have used the microkernel approach. Microkernel approach of designing the structure of the operating system. After that, in the microkernel, we have the modular approach. And the fifth one is the hybrid approach that we have discussed right now, hybrid approach. So these are the five basic approach for designing the operating system structure. So with this we are ending.